What up, YouTube? It's time to brew some beer. Very exciting brew day today. I am brewing a basic Hefeweizen kit. But the reason why this is an exciting day is for two reasons. The first one is I will be milling my own grains now. I'm gonna be testing that out today and also tweaking it. So that could go one of two ways. I could end up with a stuck sparge, or I could end up with a low efficiency. But eventually you gotta start doing this somewhere. You gotta tune it, you gotta get it set. You'll do the adventure with me. The second thing, which is the biggest thing, anybody who's been following me for a while knows I've been talking about going all electric for a long period of time and pull the trigger. The brew system version, I'm not sure what we're on, now includes a full electric controller. Courtesy of Electric Brewing Supply, shout out to them. Very easy to work with, incredibly friendly, and I would highly recommend going with them. I did have them build this panel itself rather than putting it together myself. The price difference of having them wire professionally was not worth how much time it was gonna take me to wire. In case any of you guys are wondering. There it is. I'm no electrician, but this is a dang clean wiring job. The big advantage, if you have anybody who's ever talked about building one of these, of running it this clean, can you run the wires everywhere? Yeah, it'll still work. But if any of these components fails, or you have to diagnose anything or troubleshoot it or check voltage, being able to clearly trace the lines and see everything is a game changer. Close this guy back up. Let's get to brewing. I'm gonna get a cool Batcave brewing panel here to replace this, but haven't done that yet. This is the christening run. This is the first batch I've brewed all electric. I have done a mock brew with just water to make sure nothing was leaking, because I'll show you here in a second all the stuff that I had to change once I get the water going. Let me get the water going. Power on. It does have a key switch, so you can hide this if you got little ones or people in your house that you don't want to mess with your brew controller, because this is 240 volt, so it'll kill you. Hot liquid tank to 160 and select that coil. I've got all three pumps going. I'll walk you through the full system because I don't think I'm going to be making too many more upgrades. If you're even considering going all electric and you can afford it, pull the trigger. So far, I haven't run a batch with this, but just the amount of time it takes in my test run to get this water, it's wintertime here. This water started off at 50 degrees. And on the test run, how long it took me to get 10 gallons of water up to the 160 that I need, it was like 30 minutes or something. It was ridiculously low. Let me get the pump going. So to go back to what I was telling you about, I did not need a condenser pump because I'm not running that. So I hooked this up to my Whirlpool pump. With the exception of the valves, I can control all the electronics, the pumps and everything like that from this panel here. This does have an emergency stop. If something's going horribly awry, you smack that, it kills this whole thing. This is the one element system, which means that it will only run one element at a time, which is fine for me. This is your selector switch. Now you could flip back and forth, start heating the boil water and maintain the water in the hot liquid tank. You just can't run both coils at the actual same time. Now let me walk you through the changes I had to do and the work I had to do to actually get this electric system up and running. If you guys have an electric system, you probably know this already, but it's fun for me. Step one, I bought this electronic control panel. We've covered that. I had to run a 240 circuit, which was actually really easy for me because my panel is right there. I did put in a 240 with a GFCI breaker because you're dealing with water and it's the safest way to do it. It's much, much more expensive than a regular 240 breaker, but hey, if it's the triple, quadruple safety net when dealing with this much electricity and water to make sure you don't get killed. It helps to open the valve. Hey, that's how you burn out your pumps, people, in case you're wondering, run them dry for a while. I mean, it technically wasn't dry because I did flood the system, but it wasn't moving water. Still have my whirlpool in here to heat that water evenly and quickly. That's the only pump I'll be running right now. Take you to the backside of the other stuff that I had to do. I opted for weldless fittings. I've been using weldless fittings on all my other connections and I love them and they're easy. You only have to drill for the electric element, the heating element and two. I opted for the tri-clamp fitting for this so that I can pull that element out of there. I believe that's gonna be critical, not so much for the water tank, but for the boil kettle to be able to clean that element easily and also replace it if for some reason, you know, I mean, these things aren't gonna last forever. You guys may have also noticed that my coil is pretty now. I replaced my coil, the one that my first attempt at bending it wasn't great. I got an actual tube bender on this one. So you'll notice all my bends are much, much cleaner. The coil's cleaner. I did that for two reasons. One, because it looks better. Two, because it functions better because I don't have all the kinks. And finalizing the system and getting everything done to where I'm just gonna keep making beer. And I also wanted to make sure that the coil bent it away on the bottom where it came up high enough to where it wasn't sitting on the heating element. I'm not gonna do it right now because the system's hot, but these are twist locks. So I can twist this off and remove the cable, and then it's just the pot, the element stays in the pot, but it makes it really easy to move these things around for cleaning purposes, dumping purposes, without dragging the cables around. And then all you do is just get these 240 four-prong twist lock, actually they're three-prong, sorry, twist lock cables, and you just run it right from the controller to the pot. When you're done with the pot, take these off, store all your stuff, store your cables, easy peasy lemon squeezy. On the next one, what I'm probably gonna do is I'll show you guys the setup procedure here so you'll see it, but I was pretty excited about getting my first brew done. These controllers have a VESA TV mount built into them, which is fantastic. I'll throw the link up to this guy here in the description. This controller weighs, they said it was about 35, maybe 40 pounds. Then you add the cable, just the weight of the cable on there. I wanted to make sure this was sturdy. This is rated up to, I think it's 115. I will double check that, but it is a heavy duty TV mount. And it does swivel, it does extend. I can collapse this back to the wall whenever I'm not using it, and I can also pull it out to kind of angle it wherever I want. It's been about 25 minutes, and we're already at 152. I don't have to worry about managing it. Electric boot, I flip the switch. I can do whatever I want. It's gonna hit 160, and then it's gonna hold 160. This light shows when the element is actually on. You'll notice when I first kicked this on, it was on solid. As you do a training process in the beginning with your system, and it tells the controller the most efficient way to bring the water up to temperature and hold it at temperature for your hot liquid tank. It's now getting close to 160, so it's cycling the element on and off to make sure that it doesn't blow past 160. We're actually behind because I haven't ground any grains yet. Now this is gonna be fun and interesting. This isn't a super complicated grain bill. This is really more of a test run than anything. I've never milled my own grains before, but I did stay at a Holiday Inn last night. Okay, the first run did nothing, so my gaps were too big. In case you guys were wondering, the temperature of my hot liquid tank is still right on point. Yeah, probably should have milled grains yesterday, huh? Smell some grains. Again. Smells good. Switch my flow rate to go into the mash tun. Technically, the temperature should still be the same. I haven't changed anything with my lines or pumps or anything like that. The only variable is going to be the coil. There's a smaller diameter coil that I put in. It may change what I have to hold my hot liquid tank at in order to keep 152 in the mash. But let me check the recipe because I might be mashing in at 150. Let's mash in. Right now, this element's gonna stop firing. completely because I moved the temperature down to 152. Orange lights let me know that this is the element that's active via the switch. I'm just gonna let it run like this. Because if I add water to this, it's gonna cool it down anyway. And I wanna get this up to 152 as fast as possible. It looks like my assessment was correct. With the new coil in, there is a difference. 154 in the hot liquid tank now holds my mash tun at 150. And we've gone from a 2 degree difference to a 4 degree difference. Now this is fun, this is experimental here. Once I get this dialed in, I mean, we're gonna be dialed in. It smells delightful. A couple of things that have been fun here that I didn't mention while I was doing it. Milling your own grains, smells delightful. I'm hoping that using milled grains will keep everything a lot more fresh, because that's kind of the whole point, is that you're not grinding them until close to brewing them. So now it's time for mash out. We're gonna bring our water up to 170, and that's gonna be easy. That's it. It's gonna bring the water up to 170. Have I mentioned that I love my electronic brew house? This is gonna go back into recirculation once I can. I'm gonna put in 4.5 gallons. I'm gonna stir it, get it all nice and mixed up. I'm gonna let it recirculate for about 5 minutes to settle everything out again, and then I'm gonna run off the rest. Now that I can really dial in the boil, I'm gonna find out what my boil off rate is. Because my boil off rate's always been an estimate, because you can never really get the exact rolling boil with a propane tank, because you're just kind of eyeballing the flame and how much it's rolling. Turn on the element, and then as it gets close to the boil temperature, you switch it from temperature control to percentage. Once you get a nice rolling boil, you can set it and know that, hey, for my setup, my bucket, all this stuff, a rolling boil is gonna be running at 65% on the heating element. You know every time you're gonna get that same heat from 65%. That means that your boil off rate, in theory, my boil off rate should be spot on or really close to it batch to batch if I'm setting the same percentage once I hit boil and boiling for the same amount of time. And I think I figured out the problem. I broke my golden rule. I'm not drinking a homebrew. I mean, what do I always say? You gotta be drinking one to make one. That's why so many things are going wrong. It can't possibly be because of I added two giant variables, well, three including the coil, into the brew process on a brew day. Or that I got no sleep last night because of my screaming son. No, it's because I wasn't drinking a beer. We'll go with that. I'm gonna go ahead and start firing up this element a little bit to start heating up that water. Because this will hold for a bit. I'm gonna set this temperature on the boil to, we'll do 210, and I'm gonna switch it over. It's gonna start firing on the heating element in the boil kettle. The reason I did 210 was because the element is gonna run at 100% until it starts getting close, and then it's gonna start cycling on and off to make sure it doesn't blow past the target temperature. So I'm gonna put it below the boiling temperature because I wanna make sure that it doesn't actually hit boil. My plan is when this gets close to boil, I'm gonna switch it over to 60% fire rate, which is what I determined with the water run, the test run, was a good rolling boil for the water. We'll see what it does on the actual brew day, because this is my first full brew, to figure out what percentage I want to run that at for a good rolling boil on my wort. I figure there's two strategies. One is to set this target temperature below the boil point so that it will never actually bring you to a boil before you could set your percentage where you want it. I think the other one would be to set it well above the boil point so that it's just gonna fire pretty much 100% until it gets to rolling boil, and then you can come change it back. Anybody who has this controller, I know the Spike Brewing System uses this exact same controller sourced by Electric Brewing Supply. If you guys have some tips, which I know people do, on using this controller the most efficient way, like what I just said about how to bring your boil up and save the most amount of time on brew day, please hit me up in the comments, because I would appreciate it, brewer to brewer. Target temperature is 210, it's at 180, and it's just now starting to cut the element off from time to time. You're getting real close to that hot break, because I'm gonna switch over to percentage. Now it's gonna show me the temperature, and the fact that it's in manual mode, and it's running the element 60% of the time. These numbers are gonna fluctuate based on what element you have, I would imagine. If I got a 5,500 watt in there, if you had a 4,500, I would imagine it would be different. Ripple versus straight, all that kind of stuff. But I'm really digging the amount of control I have and ease of use that I've got with this. I almost had a boil over, started foaming up because I bumped this thing up to 65. And it was real easy to just cut the electricity real quick to prevent a boil over. Not as easy with a flame. And that's what my rolling boil looks like at 60%. We're gonna add our hops to start our time. First addition is bittering hops. Might be too high. Let's try 55. I got this guy kind of set up as a drainage system. This is the lowest point right here on all of my plumbing, essentially. So right now this is recirculating, so this side is closed off. If I drop this, it'll just drain everything from inside the Herms coil and the plumbing here into this bull pipe. I do need to create a clear, I think a better cable management system back here, just to keep all this stuff cleaner. Everybody's favorite part of brewing, cleanup. Don't use your teeth to open things, kids. We put in our flavoring hops, our aroma hops. One other thing, work with tablet for clarity. It is a Hefeweizen, so probably not gonna get that clear, but it ain't gonna hurt. Shoot some work to here to get this sanitized. And I'm just gonna kick on this pump for a second just to make sure it flows through. Then my immersion chiller. I mounted this to make it hang from the side of the pot. The reason I did this was because I didn't want this sitting on the heating element. I've seen people who have made little, you know, feet for this so that it sits on the bottom of the pot, but I didn't have the extra material to make the feet for it. And then as I was trying to put it in there and saw how it was sitting, I was like, why don't I just hang it from the side of the pot? Keep it off of the element. And then I'm not worried about that at all. And that's our boil. So we're gonna cut off the element, start our whirlpool pump, and start our chiller. Whoop. Houston, we have a problem. Somebody didn't tighten their hose clamp on enough. You see, all these problems, this is what happens when you're not drinking one when you're making one. I'm telling you, it's karma. There it is, the first run of the electric brew house. ABV came out at 5.9, which is good. I'm happy with that. My brew house efficiency was low. I don't know if that was because the debacle that I had with grinding the grains or just because the grains were old. Now that I've kind of worked out some of the kinks of the grinder, hopefully, I am going to run a couple of back-to-back batches to do some efficiency checks, just to kind of tweak the system. Really happy with electric brew house, with the ease of automation, the ease of a brew day and being able to lock in those temperatures and know that if I walk away and I'm doing something else, I'm not gonna blow past it. And I feel like I'm gonna be able to get a lot more consistency out of my home brews based on the accuracy of the temperatures, the timing, and being able to just duplicate a brew day more meticulously. I am going to start doing water additions, basic water additions, to just try and meet flavor profiles. So that'll probably be in my next video. But overall, really, really happy with the electric brew house upgrade. If you guys have any tips or tricks, hit me up in the comments, because I'm always trying to expand my brew knowledge. And as always, keep brewing.